in the context of evolution of plants, and specifically the peyote plant. The peyote plant didn't anticipate the emergence of humans who would become peyote herbivores.
Peyote exists much before we do, as a species.
Oh yeah, I'm pretty sure it does.
My name is Bia Labate, and I'm on a journey to discover more about peyote, a cactus native to large parts of Mexico and southwestern Texas, which contains the psychedelic compound mescaline. As an anthropologist, I have long studied psychoactive substances and the people and practices around them. For this series, I have come to West Texas to meet Dr. Martin Terry, a leading cactus expert and conservationist, to learn more about his curious relationship with peyote and his tireless work to understand it and ensure its survival. On our first day, Martin takes us to the deserts around Alpine to hunt the elusive peyote in its natural habitat. We're gonna climb here to see if we find some peyote. What is it?
Indeed, yeah. And peyote tends to like being up off of the desert flats.
Since when are you doing this kind of work, Martin?
Oh, you could say, in the broadest sense of answering that question, yeah. 1968.
Okay.
That was when I first saw peyote in habitat. I was able to study under Richard Evans Schultes. And I caught his enthusiasm about the peyote and the people who use peyote sacramentally, which meant Native Americans.
Once widespread throughout Mexico, ritual use of peyote was largely wiped out by Spanish colonization, but today persists among indigenous groups such as the Huichol, Cora, Tarahumara, and some communities of Tepehuan. During the 19th century here in the US, peyote rituals developed involving all-night teepee ceremonies. In 1918, American Indian tribes in Oklahoma banded together to form the Native American Church, combining Native American religion and elements of Christianity, whose sacramental use of peyote has since spread to other Native American groups on the continent. What does the cactus bring on you when
well,
you see one?
Well, they are absolutely beautiful. The colors of the plant, the morphology of the plant, they're very striking.
It's beautiful. I can relate to that. I feel the same. It's just the poetics of it, the how simple it is, you know, and how it transmits this sense of presence. But hi, I'm an anthropologist. I would never say something like, the morphology is striking. What the hell does that mean, Martin Terry?
That means that the structure of the plant, the physical structure of the plant, is beautiful.
How so? Explain, translate to us that are lovers of the plant, but not so nerdy like you.
The ribs, what we call the ribs of the cactus, all of which converge to the center of the plant.
Usually in odd numbers, correct?
It's usually in Fibonacci numbers.
But
you add the two numbers, the two last numbers in the series to get the next number.
One and one?
Is two.
Two. Two and one?
Three.
And?
Three and two?
Five. Five and three, eight.
There you go. You got it.
Keep my eyes open already?
Not yet. We're still on the North Slope. You can keep them open, but you won't find anything on the North Slope.
No special discoveries.
Nope.
We know that it has historical evidence of at least 6,000 years.
Yes, human interest, because the artifacts that were found in the Shumla caves, basically, they were in caves that were inhabited by people. These peyote effigies were human creations.
But you don't know what they created them for?
No, that's what we don't know.
And what is your theory? I bet you have one.
Well, they probably ground peyote up, maybe dried it first, then ground it up, and they may have put other plants in with it. Then they
shaped it into.
And then they formed it into the shape of a peyote button, put it by the fire, allowed it to dry, and that's what we're seeing today.
I spotted one.
All right. Where is it?
Good day in West Texas. Right there.
Yes.
Big
okay.
One.
It is a big one.
Certainly is.
Put your hands on it.
Yes. And what do you feel? Does it feel spiny?
No.
Does it feel more or less soft?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Don't you think that might make a plant like that, let's say, subject to herbivory if it has no external protection?
Sure.
Yes. But
because
the fact is, you rarely see it nibbled on. Why would that be?
Because we're saying it's bitter.
It's bitter. That's the mescaline. That's the alkaloids. So it uses alkaloids instead of spines because it lacks spines. It doesn't need spines.
Mescaline is the principal psychoactive compound in the peyote cactus. Its effect on humans upon ingestion include altering the user's perception, the triggering of auditory and visual effects, including synesthesia, and more subjectively, profoundly mystical and transcendental states. But Marty, isn't it like, this is like the utmost anticlimax explanation?
That's because...
you would imagine any kind of like true seeker for knowledge and wisdom on planet that thinks that this plants, you know, have so much to teach us, and that once you have the privilege to eat them, you commune with them, and you kind of transform into their subjectivity, and you sort of acquire these visions and understand reality. But no, in fact, the mescaline is there to protect the plant from being bitten and eaten.
Exactly.
And it's
the plant...
very, very, very bitter, and that's
yes.
why people shouldn't eat it. And because man is stubborn, he will eat despite the fact that it is.
He will eat it because it is bitter.
I am trying sincerely to understand, you know, your logic and your science and your studies and your path. And I just have it a little bit of a hard time to find that there is no, like, you know, mystical avenue. There seems to be none at all in the way you explain things.
People are interested in certain species such as peyote, such as San Pedro, such uh-huh. as ayahuasca. Because of the benefit that the humans derive from eating that plant.
So it's our need.
It's and our now, need, absolutely.
It has
it
nothing
has to nothing, do with peyote.
And the peyote doesn't have any agenda or any...
I don't believe that it does. If you can convince me, I'll listen.
And have you tried it, Martin?
Yes, I have.
Yeah.
When someone asked Richard Schultes a question like that in an open public debate one time, he said, well, I could never report authentically as a scientist on something that I had not personally experienced. And I feel the same way.
So I could define you as a cactus nerd.
Definitely.
Yes.
I am a cactus nerd.
And you don't take offense?
Not a bit.
Okay.
I consider it a compliment. It's the 10th of January, and I still ain't got no sleep. She comes waltzing in the nighttime, made of wings. She is dressed up like a bandit with 100 sparkling rings, looking for my company to keep. Coming closer to me, she doesn't say.